Show. I'm your host, Seth Schoon, and we'll be delving into America's hard-earned freedoms and hard-earned history. My show is devoted to telling Americans their lost and forgotten history, and why we have our freedoms, and why they are God-given rights and freedoms. So tonight, I will start off by reading from the Declaration of Independence, because I believe most Americans do not hear it enough these days, or do not know what it really says or means. So just listen in right now. The Declaration of Independence, 1776. In Congress, July 4th, 1776. The unanimous declaration of the 13 United States of America. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes. And accordingly, all experience hath shewn that mankind are more disposed to suffer, while evils are sufferable, than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same object, evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government, and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferance of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former sister systems of government. The history of the present King of Great Britain is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all having in direct object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let facts be submitted to a candid world. He has refused his assent to laws, the most wholesome and necessary for the public good. He has forbidden his governors to pass laws of immediate and pressing importance, unless suspended in their operation till his assent should be obtained, and when so suspended, he has utterly neglected to attend to them. He has refused to pass other laws for the combination of large districts of people, unless those people would relinquish the right of representation in the legislature, a right inestimable to them and formidable to tyrants only. He has called together legislative bodies at places unusual, uncomfortable, and distant from the despotery of their public records, for the sole purpose of fatiguing them into compliance with his measures. He has dissolved representative houses repeatedly for opposing with manly firmness his invasions on the rights of the people. He has refused for a long time after such dissolutions to cause others to be elected, whereby the legislative powers, incapable of annihilation, have returned to the people at large for their exercise, the state remaining in the meantime exposed to all the dangers of invasion from without and convulsions within. He has endeavored to prevent the population of these states, for that purpose obstructing the laws for naturalization of foreigners, refusing to pass others to encourage their migrations hither, and raising the conditions of new appropriations of lands. He has obscured the administration of justice by refusing his assent to laws for establishing judiciary powers. He has made judges dependent on his will alone for the tenure of their offices and the amount and payment of their salaries. He has erected a multitude of new offices and sent hither swarms of officers to harass our people and eat out their substance. He has kept among us, in times of peace, standing armies, without the consent of our legislators. He has affected to render the military independent of and superior to the civil power. He is combined with others to subject us to a jurisdiction foreign to our Constitution and unacknowledged by our laws, giving his assent to their acts of pretended legislation, for quartering large bodies of armed troops among us, for protecting them by a mock trial from punishment for any murders which they should commit on the inhabitants of these states, for cutting off our trade with all parts of the world, for imposing taxes on us without our consent, for depriving us in many cases of the benefits of trial by jury, for transporting us beyond seas to be tried for pretended offenses, for abolishing the free system of English laws in a neighboring province, establishing therein an arbitrary government, and enlarging its boundaries, so as to render it at once an example and fit instrument for introducing the same absolute rule in these colonies, for taking away our charters, abolishing our most valuable laws, and altering fundamentally the forms of our governments, for suspending our own legislators and declaring themselves invested with power to legislate for us in all cases whatsoever. He has abdicated government here by declaring us out of his protection and waging war against us. He has plundered our seas, ravaged our coasts, burnt our towns, and destroyed the lives of our people. He is at this time transporting large armies of foreign mercenaries to complete the works of death, desolation, and tyranny, already begun with circumstances of cruelty and perfidy, scarcely paralleled in the most barbarous ages, and totally unworthy of the head of a civilized nation. He has constrained our fellow citizens taken captive on the high seas to bear arms against their country, to become the executioners of their friends and brethren, or to fall themselves by their hands. He has excited domestic insurrections among us, and has endeavored to bring on the inhabitants of our frontiers the merciless Indian savages, whose known rule of warfare is an undistinguished destruction of all ages, sexes, and conditions. In every stage of these oppressions, we have petitioned for redress in the most humble terms. Our repeated petitions have been answered only by repeated injury. A prince whose character is thus marked by every act which may define a tyrant is unfit to be the ruler of a free people. Nor have we been wanting in attention to our British brethren. We have warned them from time to time of attempts by their legislature to extend an unwarrantable jurisdiction over us. We have reminded them of the circumstances of our immigration and settlement here. We have appealed to their native justice and magnanimity, and we have conjured them by the ties of our common kindred to disavow these usurpations, which would inevitably interrupt our connections and correspondence. They too have been deaf to the voice of justice and of consanguinity. We must therefore acquiesce in the necessity which denounces our separation, and hold them as we hold the rest of mankind, enemies in war, and peace friends. We therefore, the representatives of the United States of America, in General Congress, assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions, do in the name and by authority of the good people of these colonies, solemnly publish and declare that these United Colonies are, and of right ought to be, free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown, and that all political connection between them and the state of Great Britain is and ought to be totally dissolved, and that as free and independent states, they have full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. Signed by John Hancock, Joseph Bartlett, Matthew Thornton, William Whipple, Samuel Adams, John Adams, Robert Treat Payne, Elbridge Gerry, Stephen Hopkins, William Ellery, Roger Sherman, Samuel Huntington, William Williams, Oliver Wolcott, William Floyd, Phil Livingston, Francis Lewis, Lewis Morris, Richard Stockton, Jonathan Witherspoon, Francis Hopkinson, John Hart, Abraham Clark, Robert Morris, Benjamin Rush, Benjamin Franklin, John Morton, George Clymer, J.A.S. Smith, George Taylor, James Wilson, George Ross, Caesar Rodney, George Reed, Thomas McKean, Samuel Chase, William Paca, Thomas Stone, Charles Carroll of Carrollton, George Wythe, Richard Henry Lee, Thomas Jefferson, Benjamin Harrison, Thomas Nelson Jr., Francis Lightfoot Lee, Carter Braxton, William Hooper, Joseph Hughes, John Penn, Thomas Hayward Jr., Edward Rutledge, Thomas Lynch Jr., Arthur Middleton, Button Gwinnett, George Walton, Lyman Hall. I hope I pronounced the names of those founding fathers right. That is the Declaration of Independence that was brought to us in 1776, and this declared us absolutely free from Great Britain. And today, we need to remember why we have this document. When people tell us, when the government tell us that we can't go out on our own streets in the town without wearing a mask, we need to remember that we have a signed document that lets us get out of our houses without being put in jail. We have a signed document that lets us walk on the streets without wearing a mask, that keeps us free and independent. And this is the Declaration of Independence. This is a signed document that we can leave our houses. We need to quit giving up our freedoms and our liberties. These are God-given rights: life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And originally in the Declaration of Independence, before it was edited by John Adams and Benjamin Franklin, I believe, that it said life, liberty, and property. And so it's not only three God-given rights, but there's four: life, liberty, property, and the pursuit of happiness. Right now, our government is trying to take away all of our liberties and freedoms, and America needs to wake up and quit rolling over and quit listening to everything that the big bad guys are saying. We need to stand up as a free, independent people and tell them, no, you cannot do this, because we will hold on to our freedom and we will hold on to our independence. We need to remember what our founders have told us. Now that I have read the Declaration of Independence, so that Americans once again realize what is inside of it and what our freedoms and liberties are and why we were impelled to get away from Great Britain, now I will talk about Columbus. Christopher Columbus today is portrayed as a bumbling idiot who bumped into America by accident, and that he was a gold-obsessed slave driver and a mass murderer. The American education system is very corrupt today. They're teaching kids trash that never happened in American history, and teaching them that our founding fathers were horrible, and that they were deists and atheists, and things that are just simply not true. I want to read you an article here about Columbus, Christopher Columbus. And really my goal is to just show you that he really was not a gold-obsessed slave driver that was just so hateful, but that he really did believe that what he was doing was for God's glory. So let me read this for you. One of the tired old myths promoted by the anti-Columbians, as they might as well be called, is that the lust for gold drove Columbus, leading him to commit innumerable atrocities. Critics shout that all wickedness was done in Columbus's vain pursuit of his obsession for gold. This accusation gets thrown in with all the others, painting Columbus as a heinous villain instead of the noble navigator as he was largely known for centuries. For example, it is common to hear anti-Columbians boast now: recent years have brought us Columbus, the bumbling idiot who bumped into America by accident, Columbus, the gold-obsessed slave driver, and Columbus, the mass murderer. Unlike many of the other accusations, Columbus's relationship with gold has always been under the spotlight. one of Columbus's crew members was even led to think that all Columbus cared for was gold. That man remarked on the second voyage. After we had rested for several days in our settlement, it seemed to the Lord Admiral that it was time to put into execution his desire to search for gold, which was the main reason he had started on so great a voyage, full of so many dangers, as we shall see more completely in the end. Often people point to this quote as definitive proof that the primary goal of Columbus was gold and wealth. Columbus only cared about getting rich, and he had enslaved, raped, pillaged, and destroyed anything that got in his way. However, this statement from Columbus' shipmate, in the midst of the anti-Columbus critics, directly contradicts everything Columbus wrote about his motivations. Based off of the overwhelmingly primary source documentation, Columbus was not an explorer driven by greed. Much rather, he was a discoverer who sought to restore a shattered world. The discovery of gold was important to him, but not at all in the way critics represent it today. First off, we must note that Columbus immediately instituted a policy of mutual free market exchange when it came to trading with the native tribes for gold. It is recorded that Columbus sought to prevent the others from imposing upon the Indians. As the Indians are so simple and the Spaniards so avaricious and grasping, it does not suffice that the Indians should give them all they want in exchange for a bead or a bit of glass. But the Spaniards would take everything without any return at all. The Admiral always prohibits this, although, with the exception of gold, the things given by the Indians are of little value. But the Admiral, seeing the simplicity of the Indians, and that they give a piece of gold in exchange for 6 beads, gives the order that nothing should be received from them unless something had been given in exchange. But ultimately, the most important question to ask is, why did Columbus search for gold? What was his ultimate motivation? If it wasn't for personal wealth, then what was it for? Thankfully, Columbus's own journal answers this question by explaining that after the first voyage, Columbus trusted in God that when he returned from Spain, according to his intention, he would find a ton of gold collected by barter by those he was to leave behind, and that they would have found the mine and spices in such quantities that the sovereigns would, in 3 years, be able to undertake and fit out an expedition to go and conquer the Holy Sepulchre. Thus, he says, I protest to ask your highnesses that all the profits of this my enterprise may be sent in the conquest of Jerusalem. Note that Columbus writes to the king and queen, explicitly calling upon them to devote all of their profits to liberate Jerusalem from the grip of the Muslim conquerors. It may be shocking to someone who only knew that in 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue, but Columbus actually considered himself someone called by God to help restore the lands conquered by Islamic jihad in the previous centuries. In another letter, he writes to Ferdinand and Isabella, explaining, the argument I have for the restitution of the Holy Temple to the Holy Church. In the same letter to the king and queen, Columbus explains that going back to St. Augustine, many within the church predicted that the world would end 7,000 years after creation. Based on the work of Augustine, Pierre Delali, and others, Columbus concluded, there are about 155 years left for the fulfillment of 7,000, at which time I said above, by the authority cited, that the world will come to an end. Columbus seriously thought that he would have a pivotal role in preparing the world for receiving the returning Messiah at his triumphant return in Jerusalem. In one of the least discussed but most important documents for understanding Columbus, called the Book of Prophecies, Columbus actually collects all the supposed evidence and prophecies for the discovery of the New World and his spiritual and religious motivations for sailing across the ocean. Therein, he presents his argument again for using the discovery to push back the Islamic invasion of the Holy Land while he still had time. He writes, who doubts that this illumination was from the Holy Spirit? I attest that he, with marvelous rays of light, consoled me through the Holy Sacred Scriptures, a strong and clear testimony, with 44 books of the Old Testament and 4 Gospels, with 23 epistles of those blessed apostles, encouraging me to proceed, and continually, without ceasing for a moment. They inflamed me with a sense of great urgency. Our Lord wished to perform the clearest miracle in this matter of the voyage to the Indies. to console me and others in this other matter of the Holy Temple. Clearly, Columbus's main motivation in seeking the New World was religiously motivated and not driven by personal greed for riches. Much rather, he advocated that all proceeds be directed to the king and queen to the interests, at the time, of the church. In fact, Columbus closes his letter to Ferdinand and Isabella, focusing on the fact that the discovery of the Indies meant that Christianity was being spread across the world. And I say that the sign which convinces me that our Lord is hastening to the end of the world is the preaching of the gospel recently in so many lands. So contrary to the anti-Columbus academics of the day, Columbus cared more about God than gold. I wanted to share that tonight because my own world history teacher has told me that Columbus was a very, very bad man who enslaved a lot of people and was only obsessed with gold and raped and he murdered. And I never really believed that, but I've never seen any evidence yet to support that until now. These are actually things that Columbus wrote. So, whenever you hear anything on my show, I don't want you to take my word for it, but look it up yourself. Because what I tell you, I always make sure that it is something that I would believe. It's something that I would believe, and I always try to search for the truth. You see, when truth is on your side, you aren't afraid of people looking up what you talk about. Because the truth will always come through, and that you always will know that the truth is real, and it's there. People lie today so much. CNN lies so much, so much. It makes me wonder how Christians can listen to CNN, because it doesn't make sense. The Holy Spirit should convict you of these lies, And I don't know how a Christian can be a Democrat anymore, being that they believe in murdering innocent babies. Christians today need to stand up for what is right. They need to stand up and get their government back to the way that it was originally intended to be. And that is based on faith, religious freedom, trust and hope in God, the Lord Jesus Christ. So I want to share some things that I have learned recently. Christians today do not believe that they should be involved in government or public life. They don't believe that they should be in politics. Most pastors these days, they want to stay 10 feet. They won't touch politics with a 10-foot pole. They won't talk politics. They won't say anything relevant to today in church. They believe and have fallen for the lie about separation of church and state. This is so sad. Christians should be out there, and pastors should be out there sharing the truth and preaching about what is relevant to today, just like they have done back in the colonial days. Those pastors, they were always teaching on what is relevant to today. Some of those pastors led their own churches up against British troops, like Pastor Jonas Clark. He led like 70 of his church members against 700 British. Amazingly brave. They were amazingly brave, these pastors. There's one pastor, Jonas Clark, back in 1775, I believe, the Battle of Lexington and Concord, you know? Well, he led like 70 of his church members against 700 British. That's bravery right there, in defense of their town and their church. It's amazing, amazing courage. I do not believe that pastors today, I do not believe that many pastors today would be able to do that. I know a few,
but not many.
Pastors once again need to learn that they can defend. They can defend. There's a biblical way of looking at this. Do not fire unless fired upon. And that's what Jonas Clark believed. And that's what he taught his church members. So the church needs to get back to doctrine. It needs to get back to reading the Bible instead of people saying their opinions. So, there's a few different things that I think Christians should start doing again. And pastors need to step up again and quit being so, I don't know, dysfunctional. Listening to the government. The separation of church and state. Pastors have bought into this lie. But it's not what the founders wanted. They believed that religion and education were the things that would create good, wise young people that were virtuous. And now today you can't say the word God in church, you can't say the word God in school. It's so crazy. Pastors, once again, need to preach on what is relevant to today. That is what they did back then. They preached on what was relevant. They didn't just go to church and pretend nothing was happening. They did things. Christians did things. That's why we had such a great country. Christian escapism is the stuff that fallen cultures are made out of. This is like Jonah. He ran and hid. People are starving for truth. We need godly infused courage. I need to say that again. That was just so good. Christian escapism is the stuff that fallen cultures are made out of. This is like Jonah. He ran and hid. People are starving for truth. We need godly infused courage. We as Christians need to quit saying we can't be in politics. Oh, we can't be involved in that. We can't be involved in that. We need to step to the plate and teach people what God says. Jesus has told us to go forth and make disciples of all men and teach them everything that he has commanded us. That means that we have to teach them all that he has commanded us. Not just tell them about Jesus and have them get saved, but we need to teach them everything that Jesus commanded us. Everything in the Bible. There are 613 civil laws in the Bible. And I don't believe many pastors even know what they are anymore. People ask, is America worth saving? I don't understand why they would even ask this question. It's just, Christians need to step up and save America. Well, the answer to that is, are people trying to get in or out? People are still trying to get into America. You can see that on the southern border right now. Illegal immigrants pouring in. America is worth saving. America has had its faults. It has done some bad things. But overall, America has been the greatest force for good out of any other nation in the world. It's just true. The church and the government can work together to make strong citizens. I'm not saying the church needs to be involved in controlling the government, and the government doesn't need to be involved in controlling the church. But together, they can equally work to make strong citizens. The government can make a good atmosphere for citizens to be raised up in. A safe place for children to be raised, where enemies aren't pouring in, like right now we're seeing from the southern border. And the church can teach them God's laws and how to be saved by Jesus. And the thing that makes a good Christian is the thing that makes a good citizen. We need to be good Christian citizens of America today and step up and tell people what is right. So God has given us this republic to be stewards over. We need to not throw that away. We need to stand up and be good stewards of this republic and restore it. And I think the best way to do that is by doing a convention of states. That is where all the state legislators, let me just read it from the Constitution for you. And that way, you can understand exactly what it is. Article 5 of the U.S. Constitution says, "The Congress, whenever two-thirds of both houses shall deem it necessary, shall propose amendments to this Constitution, or, on the application of the legislatures of two-thirds of the several states, shall call a convention for proposing amendments, which in either case shall be valid to all intents and purposes as part of this Constitution, when ratified by the legislators of three-fourths of the several states, or by conventions in three-fourths thereof, as the one or the other mode of ratification may be proposed by the Congress, provided that no amendment which may be made prior to the year 1808 shall in any manner affect the first and fourth clauses in the ninth section of the first article, and that no state without its consent shall be deprived of its equal suffrage in the Senate." So, the long and short of that means that we the people can call a convention of states. We can have our legislators that we elect to go to this convention. And that every state that goes to this convention, has to be 34 out of the 50, can vote to make amendments that restrain the federal government. This is a wonderful way where Christians can get involved in getting their government the way it should be, in promoting good and virtue again. Christians today need to step up. I've learned right here, where was it? Well, the vast majority of the first battles fought in the Revolutionary War were by pastors and their churches. Can you believe this? God has not given us to start wars, but defend. It's amazing. We need to defend. America's Hollywood was kept in check by the church for quite a while. But just recently, like in 1962, until 1962, the church had to sign off on different movies that were going to be produced. The church used to be involved. God has given us all these different spheres of influence that we can be involved in. I don't understand why pastors say, well, we can't be in politics. It doesn't make any sense. We're called to be good stewards. Why are we out there promoting good and right and virtue in Christ's salvation? Until 1962, the church used to have to say, well, this movie has something bad in it. We can't let this be out there. We got to cancel it. And when they all had to be checked by the church. I think I've read somewhere that, or I heard somewhere that during that time, there was like 17 communications or 17 churches that were talking and discussing this one video. All because there was one word in it. And it was, frankly, dear, I don't give a blank. And the churches, they discussed just that little word. And today we see horrible things in movies today. Horrible things coming out of Hollywood. Horrible, horrible, horrible things. So you see what happens when the church is out of society, when the church is pushed away, when the church says, oh, well, we won't be involved in that. The church needs to be involved in every aspect of life in America if we want to have a virtuous and good country. That's all I have today on Freedom and Independence Show. Check out the YouTube channel. Keep looking for more videos coming up on the Freedom and Independence Show. If you're listening to this, you can listen to this when you're driving down the road, when you're at work, when you're outside. You don't have to watch the video, you can just listen. It's a great show to get informed on our God-given freedoms and rights. And our history that people are trying to erase. Stand fast. stand fast for God and our country. Be good biblical citizens of America. Check out Patriot Academy online, and check out Convention of States online, and check out Wall Builders online. Amazing things to look at. Amazing people who are behind this. Amazing patriot Christians. You need to check in all of these and get involved in all of these as Christian biblical citizens of America. And if you are not a Christian, then I encourage you to accept Christ as your Savior and believe that He has died for you on a cross and been buried, but then was raised again alive, and that He has done this for you to forgive your sins. Accept Him as your Savior today and repent of your sins and turn to Jesus. And that way that you can be a biblical citizen of America and to stand for right, because right makes might. And we must remember that today. Thank you for watching.